Joining us in the studio this morning, this is her first live interview since she came out with the allegations, Patricia Bautista and her lawyer, Attorney Martin Loan. Welcome to Hot Copy, Tisha. Thank you for coming to the show, Attorney Martin. Thank you for coming. What could have been a simple domestic squabble, ordinary between many couples in many marriages in the Philippines, has turned out to be a domestic, has turned out to be a national interest issue. Tisha, what made you decide to come out with this? Why now? What pushed you? And what drove you?
Well, thank you for having us. And yes, this is my first and possibly my last. But in truth, regardless of the differences that Andy and I have had, I have never, ever taken into consideration that he would ever put my children in harm's way or myself in harm's way. But discovering these things changed my mind because of his position and the possible ramifications that it may entail if things are discovered to be remiss in some way.
Okay.
So that is the reason why. Now, we've been estranged for a while. I have.
He says since 2013.
Since 2013. Again, I have been trying to separate. I have gone to different law firms. I've gone to the big law firms. And again, once they know that it's him, they're hands off. So I have tried very hard to, but again, no lawyer would take me precisely because it's him. I have been told many times by him that, you know, he is very good friends in high places, and, you know, whether it's the ombudsman, the justices, senators, etc. And I would be very naive to think that just judges cannot be bought and all of that. So again, I tried to get a lawyer and nothing happened. Nobody came. They could only give me advice on the side.
Yeah.
Do a separation de facto, is that what it's called?
Yeah.
So at least you do it peacefully, and that's what I was trying to do.
Okay.
Now, when I discovered all of these things, and again, like I said, what changed my mind was, I guess, the sheer volume of what I found, right? I decided I would try again to try to get a lawyer, and I found my first lawyer, really, Lorna Kapunan. Again, I think she has personal history with Andy, which unfortunately became a difficult aspect of my case. But again, Lorna and I remain to be friends, and she still, as my friend and as my former counsel, still defends me, so I do appreciate that. But she also understood that the reason it took so long, because I think Andy was saying in another interview, why did it take 10 months? Why only now? It's because he refused to come to the table. He refused to speak to Lorna. She said she was an evil person together with Bingo and so on. So, and I don't even know Bingo and so on.
Okay.
You know, and he was saying that he just refused. You know? So his friend, Howie Calieja, became like a mediator. Other friends, my brother. And it was very difficult because I would ask, what are your properties? He would tell me, you tell me the property, I'll tell you if it's mine.
Yeah.
How do you go about trying to figure out what is legitimate or what is yours versus what is not yours? So it did take time. And again, we had mediators. And in the end, he talks about the commercial agreement that we had, which, by the way, was not 620, it was 260.
Oh,
so I'm not dyslexic.
Really? Yeah.
Not 260.
And
I have
not 620.
No.
Because he was saying you were asking for 620 million, which was, he said, an absurd amount.
We had we had a mediator, we had a term sheet. And the total, including, and again, 85%, 75% of it was a trust for my kids.
Mm-hmm.
Not for me, for my kids. And I really wanted it that way. One third, 75%, more or less. So, again, I was very willing already. I said, you know what, it's impossible for me at this point to take your word for this is yours, this is not mine, this is my brother's. I don't know, right?
Yeah.
So I said, okay, this amount, as long as there's a trust for my kids, I'm good with. The only problem was, I think he failed to mention that settlement was held for ransom unless I signed a clause that I could choose. Either something that basically said during the term sheet that I did not find any of these things, illegal or anything wrong with them. I did my due diligence. Now, I started to think, if there's nothing wrong with it, why do I need to sign anything that says I didn't find anything wrong with it? Or I could sign the draft, a statement that would basically disbar Lorna Kapunan. how can I do either, right? How can
so
I do
these
either?
Were the conditions
this
he
is the
set
conditions.
To give you 260 million?
Yes, I have a term sheet.
Okay, so by this time, he already knew you found all of these documents?
He found more or less, yes. You know, there's a sheet that he was given as to more or less what I, you know, because I, again, what are they? I don't know what they are. This is the whole purpose, right? And what happened was, he was just harping about Lorna. And I guess Lorna, knowing that at the end of the day, it would be a hindrance for me. I guess she understood why I had to take her out of the equation.
So then, in a way, you removed Lorna and got a new set of lawyers.
Yes, because that seemed to be the problem, right?
Yeah.
And so he tried again. Martin tried. And again, they asked, why did we go to Duterte? Why did we? The bottom line is, like you said, it was a domestic
issue.
So I only want what is legally mine as a wife of 17 years with four children. So my main concern was to basically find what really is our finances, which belongs to us and which don't. I wasn't getting any straight answers from Andy, despite the fact that he says he can show. How will I know, right? So that's why I decided the person who will understand all of this should be somebody beyond reproach, cannot, you know, beyond corruption and all of that. And we went to President Duterte.
Okay, but many people are asking, why President Duterte?
Because
I mean, by going to him, you put your husband's reputation at risk. In a way, you report some questionable assets he may have. Go ahead.
But the reason is, remember, I mean, even my entire experience of this, I was constantly told that he has friends, especially the ombudsman. He's very close to the ombudsman. And I know that. She's very close to my mother as well.
Mm-mm.
So the ombudsman, justices, senators, my own experience going to the big law firms like Romulo and all of that, they refused to touch it. So I was of the opinion that he was probably right. So I had to go to somebody who was not corruptible.
So what you felt, is it right to say, because you felt you had no connections, you felt helpless, you went to the highest person in the land?
Isn't that what you're supposed to do as a private citizen?
Now, did Lisa Marcos, Araneta, or Araneta Marcos, facilitate your meeting with Duterte? And the reason I'm asking this is it's been going around. You might as well clarify it. How would someone like you and Attorney Martin get an appointment with the president?
Oh, absolutely. Me, I don't even know Lisa Marcos. So absolutely not. I mean, these are...
Ma'am, maybe it wasn't Tita Lisa who set the meeting. If it were her, I would have told you so, but it wasn't her. I just want to protect the identity of the friend who helped us set the meeting with the president. But definitely it was not Tito Bong or Tita Lisa.
Would
at all.
It be okay if you just mentioned? Because at least it clarifies things,
ma'am,
and people kind of know about it.
I don't want to mention his name unless I have his consent. But
okay.
I will only mention his name if I have his consent. I'm trying to get in touch with him. I'll try to get in touch with him if it's okay.
So it's the person close to the president?
Very close to the president.
Okay.
And
it's your friend?
Close friend as well. Yes,
okay,
ma'am.
Because I'm not allowed to mention it if you don't want.
Yes,
so
ma'am.
Let's start with this. When did you discover all of this? So here you were. At first, you wanted to separate. You still want to separate. And you just wanted what you felt legally was yours for you and your kids.
Yes.
You had a difficult time. And Chairman Bautista said he went to the States and the bank called him. You started withdrawing $117,000, moving it to your personal account. And was this the time you found this?
Let me explain that. When I did that, first of all, it's a joint account, completely joint, okay? The reason I wasn't hiding anything because, you know, if I wanted to hide something and not have anybody pull out the red flag, I would have withdrawn less than $500,000, right? But
yeah.
I took everything, right? At least 117 at that time. I don't know what else is there. But the reason I moved it to another account is because I discovered that the manager of that account, BDO in the fort, was in cahoots with him. I found... what do you call this? A promissory note from a client, and I have it, and I can give it to you. These clients who were clients of the bank, but instead of getting a loan from BDO, this at least it appeared from the papers, right? This manager was, I think, made Andy made them borrow money from Andy, and basically created a transaction where instead of getting the loan from the bank, Andy was the lender.
Okay. Oh.
So you know how, like, she's the manager. Yeah. These bank, these clients come to her knowing, she knows that they want a loan, but perhaps the interest is not as, maybe the interest is too high or whatever. So at least, again, this is from what was in the paper. No, it was basically a promissory note.
So in effect, what you're saying, that's why you withdrew $117,000 from your joint account.
And put it in a, because he's saying that I put it in a different bank, yeah. Right? The reason I didn't, I did it that way, right, was because I didn't trust the bank manager in BDO knowing that I found this promissory note and I have the actual PDC and all of that. So I don't trust anybody anymore.
Okay.
Right?
No. So moving forward, I've asked you, because Andy mentioned that in the press con, what did you find? I mean, you are essentially, you and your team are accusing the Comelec chairman, who is your husband, of more than a billion pesos of undeclared wealth. It's a very serious allegation that could get him impeached, frankly speaking. So what did you find?
Okay. Okay. Sorry, before I begin, let me just clarify what you asked me.
Yeah.
Why did I withdraw the $117,000? It's because I knew Andy, knowing that I had this, would probably squeeze me with regard to finances, which is technically what he's doing. And that's why we filed the Bausi. So at least I had enough funds to take care of me and the kids for at least a little while, as to depending on how this turned out. So in answer to your question, that was the reason why. Okay. So going back to this, what we found was a number of different things. He knows about this. He said that, you know, maybe we fabricated it, or there are 32 or something passbooks there.
These are the passbooks. These are for Luzon Development Bank. Yes. There are 32 passbooks.
For two branches.
32 branches.
No. 32 passbooks for two branches.
For two branches, 32 passbooks for two branches. And what would be questionable with what's inside the passbooks? Why would you doubt that they're legal?
Well, for one, I don't know why you would need, at least in one branch, in two branches combined, 32 passbooks. And they're all with this family and his... and the total of one branch is about 200,000 plus, 200 million plus. And the other branch is about 100 million. So the total is 300 million.
Plus, it all in Luzon Development Bank.
Yes, but what's interesting about it, and my lawyers were telling me this, was that the deposits were all below 500,000,
mostly,
and they were done. The deposits were done almost every day. From when is the date?
2014.
Yeah. Okay. But then you have also Andy. To be fair to him, saying, you know, Karen, I was head of Shangri-La.
Yes,
I went to New York. I did these things.
Absolutely.
It's my family's personal wealth.
Absolutely.
Why would we think that the money that he's depositing would be coming from a questionable source?
What I think is bothersome for me is that his salary is 176. So however much you cut it, whether he can say that I don't have 1 billion, I have, pretend, 900 million or 800 million or whatever, it's still higher than his salary, right? That for me is what is questionable.
Yeah. Now, Tisha, many wives may know something questionable about their husbands, but they don't go out and actually expose it. This is what is that's the back of the minds of many people. What would drive someone like Patricia Bautista, who many people know as very sweet, quiet, love and
very
light,
private,
and then go to this extreme of being the one to expose your husband? Some people would assign it to someone else, but you did it yourself.
Yes.
What would drive you to do this?
Because at the end of the day, like I said, I feel by doing this, by being as careless or as whatever it is, it would put my children in danger. Because what would happen if somebody actually comes out and proves that all of this is true and whatever the verdict is, right? And number one, nobody will believe that I don't know anything after 17 years of marriage, estranged or not, right? People may think I'm complicit, right? But more so for my kids, when they see both their parents, right, are a certain way. And I, at least for me, I want to make sure that my kids, for them, I know it's difficult for them and it's a really, really difficult time, and I would have preferred not to make them go through this. But they have to know also, you know, you have kids,
yeah,
and you know that more than what you tell them, it's what you show them. And they have to know also the difference that between right and wrong, and more than that, the corruption is not okay, right? And at
so
least
you're
they
saying,
have one parent.
You are saying Andy is corrupt.
Well, again, I guess we have to prove that. But there is enough here for me to wonder, put
okay.
it that way. For
Did
me to
you
wonder.
Tell your children about this before you were coming out?
I told them, the older ones, so my kids are very young. So I told them enough, I think, enough for them to process. But again, I said their father is not a bad person, but he's made very bad choices that I'm not willing to live with, and I don't think that they should live with as well.
Yeah.
So again, I don't do this because I want a bad mouth. I want to. It's not. I again, people may not believe that, but you know that's up to them. I did this really because I want to make sure that my children are protected, that there's at least one parent that is not like the other one, in case this is proven that it is the way it is, right?
Yeah.
So, again, why would I want to do this? Like you said, I'm a very private person. I'm a very quiet person. I barely have the constitution to sit here in front of cameras, and you know. So, for those people that know me, they know that. So this is a big deal. I mean, in every aspect of the word. So if you ask me, what was bothersome? You know, you have.
Okay.
You have documents like that, the total 200 million. And then you have checkbooks where this is Andy's handwriting, not mine. And you see they're all payable to
yeah.
LDB, from a BDO account to an LDB account.
Okay.
I don't understand what that
yeah.
means.
You wanted to say something, Attorney Martin?
Yes, ma'am. If you notice the checkbooks, ma'am, all of these are handwritings of Chairman Andy himself, as alleged by his wife. And they contain, ma'am, balance brought forward payable to LDB with the amounts of 450,000, 300,000, 250,000, etc.
Then someone might ask, what's wrong with that?
Ma'am, the problem with this, ma'am, is the dates written here by him, by the chairman himself.
Yes. Can you put it up like this?
Are fairly recent, ma'am.
Mm-mm.
And it's highly questionable where he would get all this money when he was working for government already at that time.
Are you saying this is you?
2014. The date here, ma'am, is
2014. So he was Comelec chairman already
PCGG,
then?
PCGG.
Okay.
And all of these were fairly recent, the discoveries of Mrs. Bautista. And,
so,
okay,
just for the record, this is 2014. He was PCGG head.
Okay.
So what you're saying is where would he get all the money that's being deposited?
Yes, ma'am. And it extended all the way, I think, ma'am, to 2016.
This
when
is
she
a,
discovered
this
the
is the bank statement, October 2016.
Okay. How sure are you that this still exists?
It probably doesn't exist anymore, right, at this point. But for me, I guess, you cannot erase from bank statement, bank, I guess, records. No, but if people don't believe this, these are all from LDB. If people
okay.
think this is fraudulent,
yeah.
this is the record from the beginning. If they feel the passbooks are not true, this is from the beginning. These are originals. These are signed by managers, etc.
Yeah.
So,
and what are these? Actually,
these,
there are envelopes here with cash.
With cash
what
inside, and we were talking about PC. These are actually pay slips. Okay, pay slips from PCGG. I don't know what do you call them.
Pay slips, salaries
for
named
other people.
To an employee.
Yes, but there's cash inside, and you can see the.
And why is it in your house?
I don't know. And you can see how it's
okay.
not torn. The money is still there.
So you didn't touch the money.
No, I will
so
not
okay.
touch the money.
So you found several envelopes.
Yes.
That are from PCGG employees' salary.
Here.
Okay.
You can see it's not signed. I guess that's a tear sheet, right? And then there's money inside. Now, I asked him about this, and he says, you know, in front of his sister. And he says, no, these are old, what do you call this, envelopes. They're just being used, etc.
Yeah.
I don't know how
but
you could
do
have...
Do these employees exist? What did you ask him? Who are these employees? Are they PCGG employees?
Maybe that's something you'll have to ask him. So.
Okay.
And that was the reason why we submitted everything to the NBI, so they can make the proper investigation to make the determination whether these are true employees
yeah.
or whether they did receive the sums
yeah.
as stated in the records.
So did you ask him, Andy, are these ghost employees and you're taking money? I mean, I'm sorry, I wonder if, did you ask him that?
No, I asked him what they were. He said, no, those are just old envelopes and, you know, they're just being reused.
Yeah. So the money is still intact. Money is still intact. Proof. You didn't touch it.
Did not touch anything. Yeah. Did not get anything.
It's actually cash inside. Okay, so the NBI has this. Did the NBI count?
I think, ma'am, we submitted everything to the copies of everything to the NBI already.
Okay. And just for the record, actually, what Patricia put on the table is this most of it, half of it, one-fourth of it?
We still have a lot.
Actually, we have one huge box there.
So actually, this is just for the audience to see.
But this is just one.
This is a box. This is the box you were talking about. And is this the only box?
No.
So there,
much more.
There are more boxes that have what?
There are different things that we found, and some of them are email, some of them are documents.
But ma'am, the contents of these things are too sensitive that it's best to disclose it, ma'am, in the proper investigation.
Yes.
Yes,
ma'am.
So these are things that, you know, because I would like to, because people are saying, oh no, she's just extorting, she's doing this, all of that stuff. So for me, it's like, you can shoot the messenger, that's okay. If you know, you can discredit me, you can destroy whatever you want. No, if it brings you joy, go ahead, right? But the message will remain the same, whether it comes from my mouth, Martin's mouth, whoever's mouth, right? The message is the same. Don't take it. Don't take my word for it. Look at the documents. These will become public documents, I guess, when they're with the NBI, and you can look, see for yourself. I'm not going to convince anybody of anything. I'm just telling people, this is what I found, and the message is this. I'm bringing you things. Bringing you things that may possibly point to graft and corruption, may possibly point to a betrayal of public trust, may possibly point to money laundering, may possibly point to election fraud. I don't know, and that's why I'm bringing it. There are people that the NBI has the forensic accounting, maybe they'll find out where all of this came from.
Now, Tisha, listening to you, it's almost like you want Andy in jail.
Well, not so much want him in jail. For me, it's this, no. Am I upset? Of course I'm upset. Who wouldn't get upset?
Put my children in harm. You're scary upset. Okay, clearly, go on.
I'm scary upset. But, like, again, as any mother, I think the lion in any mother will come out when she feels that her children could be put in harm's way. Other people might say, no, you're damaging them by doing this. My thing is this, why are people getting upset at me for exposing this and not realizing that I'm not the source of all of this happening, right? But, you know, that's another story. Now, for me, I guess you have to do what's right at the end of the day, right? You have to do what's right. And, you know, I have to say that, like Andy came out in the other, in another interview, and he was basically saying how, you know, his family's behind him. In fact, my mother is behind him.
Why would your mother be behind him and not you?
Well, there's a lot of history there, but I mean, I'm sure there's a lot of parental fondness for Andy. But it also is another thing that through Divina Law holds my stepfather's estate.
Yeah.
Okay, which technically, at the end of the day, knock on wood, if something were to happen to my stepfather, will end up being my mother's estate. Now, if something were to happen to my stepfather, I'm sure my mom feels she will need protection from Andy. So, does that explain why she's on his side? I don't know. You decide.
Okay.
Right?
Now, before we go to a quick break, you often talked about, I want to do what's right. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to go to this part. It's a bit sensitive on your end. Okay. Andy yesterday said he was the true victim. That you were an adulterer, you were unfaithful to him, and the reason that you are doing all this is essentially to be with Alvin Lim. I have to say the name because the papers already publicly wrote about it. I think it's the front page of the Philippine Star today. And so the question is, number one, Tisha, are you seeing somebody else?
No.
You are not?
No. We're friends. We're very good friends. We've worked together, so if you see pictures of us together, it's normal. We've worked together. Again, this
So you don't have a relationship with him other than friendship?
Yes, we're very close. We're both energy healers. People can interpret that the way they want. I mean, this is a rumor that was started by his ex-girlfriend, Margarita Forrest, 4 or 5 years ago. And it's still there. And I've never said anything, but because for me, what people think of me is not my business. It's up to them. Right, I'm not going to convince anybody. But at the end of the day, if he wants to talk about infidelity, I would be very careful if I were him, because again, I can defend whatever he throws at me. I don't know if he can do the same. And in many ways, there are a lot of people that will be affected if he decides, you know, you know, there are people that will be affected, and his friends, etc. And I have four children, and they're boys.
So what you're saying, you don't want to go that route.
Because it will just distract from all of this. And this is the problem. My domestic problems have been there for a long time, even before 5 years ago. And people who know me know that, right? So even they were like, oh God, you know, just it's just a distraction again, to distract from what the issue is, right? This is the issue, not my issue. We have enough drama already in our country, in the world. We don't need another telenovela. I am not going to burden people with my sob story, because it's, what for? So this, we're not going to waste airtime talking about that. But if he would like to do that, like I said, I can defend myself. Can he? You know, it's up to him.
All right, we're going to take a quick break. We'll be right back with our interview with Patricia Bautista and Attorney Martin Loon after this short break. Stay with us. Welcome back. You're watching Head Start. This is the second half of Hot Copy. Still with us is Patricia Bautista. This is her first live television interview after the allegations she's made against Comelec Chair Andy Bautista. A question came in, Tisha, during the break and said, if you are good, why would you want half of what Andy owns, which is perceived to be questionable or coming from anomalous sources?
Let me make it clear. By law, I'm entitled to half of what Andy owns, but I want half only of what is clean. This is why I'm bringing it to the government to tell me which part is clean.
Really?
Which part is clean?
When people were reports coming out, you wanted half. You're not saying you want half of the alleged 1 billion.
No, I want half of what is clean. Now, if you tell me that 1 billion is clean, 500 million is clean, 300, yes, I will get one half of what is clean. Yes. I would not do all of this and then get into the muck as well with all of this.
Yeah,
I want a clean break.
Some people are saying with Tisha doing this, she's not going to get anything.
Absolutely. So this is the most inefficient, if I'm after the money, this is the most inefficient way to do it. Is it not? Whatever I get, I will get through the courts, through Vowsy.
Yes.
And I'm hoping that Andy was wrong when he said that judges can be bought. So I'm getting it through the courts. I'm not getting anything. So for me, let me make it clear. I want one half as per what is due me by law, but one half of what is clean. And that's why I brought this. Please tell me what is clean.
And what is his?
And what is whatever it is.
Okay, did you want to add something?
Ma'am, I just wanted to add that in terms of the negotiation, ma'am, the settlement was about the separation of the properties. We were never willing to settle about concealing a crime. Because I think party, that was what they wanted us to do in the settlement. Return Ata everything to them, and then they give her share.
This is before the meeting with President Duterte?
Yes, ma'am, before the meeting.
Clarify that.
So I just want to clarify.
So this is the 260 million peso agreement, and supposedly
90,
Andy...
90. 90.
But 90 for me, and the rest are for the kids.
So this is the 150 million agreement wherein Andy said, I'll give it if you...
Yes, ma'am.
If you sign that... Yes, everything ma'am. You found, nothing, it was questionable, you've done your due diligence, and you file a disbarment case against
Lorna
Help Kapunan. Them file it.
Help them file it. Go on. So, he had two conditions.
Yes, ma'am. And my point was this, ma'am. We don't need to agree to those conditions to get what is rightfully hers, because it's hers. They have no prenuptial agreements, and therefore she owns half of everything that's clean. Now, they wanted us to do other things to get what is rightfully hers. Eh, we were thinking, ma'am, it was a bit morally...
So you're saying he wanted her to compromise?
To compromise. And it was a bit morally questionable for him and his sister, Susan, ma'am, to want us to conceal all of this and sign an agreement that we won't reveal anything just for her to get her rightful share. And that was what was so unacceptable. Because, ma'am, she could have gotten her rightful share with or without concealing anything, with or without disbarring anything.
Yeah.
But I think, ma'am, they were making it difficult for her by adding all these conditions. Ma'am, if they were not hiding anything, ma'am, those things need not have been in those conditions. Why will they impose it on her to conceal all of these questionable documents if at all these documents were actually clean? So that was my wonder, and that's what I told Tish. And I told Susan Afan, ma'am, I think, the sister, when we were negotiating.
Ma'am, just for transparency purposes, yes, Susan, the sister of Andy, works in ABS-CBN Foundation.
Yes,
which I just... found out they were brother and sister yesterday.
Yes,
go on.
So, ma'am, that's why I have a text message here to Ma'am Susan Afan, and I told her, ma'am, I think it's better for the courts to decide na lang on which assets should be separated and which assets are the ones that belong to the community property. And she agreed. And I have all the text messages with her, ma'am, in that whole negotiation. Because, ma'am, for us, especially for her and for the lawyers, we felt that it was already immoral, illegal, unethical for us to participate in the concealment of what could possibly be a very big crime. Okay. That was why, ma'am, we really felt it necessary to turn these things over to the NBI.
Okay. Tisha, you were going to show something.
Because we were talking about the commissions, and I think in another interview, Andy said that, you know, the client, there's nothing wrong with, they get referral fees, right? That's what he said.
Yes.
Now, from what I know, and as per my lawyers, you're not supposed to do that when you're in government. But let's just go with his argument and say that they were referral fees. Although I'm not an accountant, I would assume that a referral fee is a fixed amount for everything that you bring in. Now, a commission is a percentage. This is a percentage. And he said that basically there are no companies in their employ that in their roster that are conflict. You have Smartmatic here. How can that not be in conflict?
Are you saying, but this you is know, the, Andy the, might say this is doctored.
Well, you know what? Why don't we do this? There is a SOA number 799, and NBI will. We've already submitted this to the NBI.
Forgive my ignorance. What SOA would
it's a statement of account.
Oh, okay. All right. Can we show this? I want the Smartmatic part. So, was Andy already Comelec chairman?
This is what year is this? This is 2016, so January to 31.
January 2016. This is just last year. I'm going to focus. So, okay. So you're saying, what are you saying? It says Smartmatic, but what are you saying, Tisha?
Well, like I said, I'm just going by what I found. And this looks like a commission sheet, right? Because it's based on a percentage, not a fee, okay? Either way, Andy made the claim that there are no, Divina Law has no clients that are, in a sense, in conflict with his position in Comelec.
Yeah.
And there's Smartmatic there. So I don't know how.
But are these Divina lawyers?
Well, you can see Nilo T. Divina. NTD, right? Isn't that his?
Yes. Okay.
Right? So this is the charges, and then he gets a percentage. Now, apart from Smartmatic, I think Baseco, which is a government-owned, isn't it a sequestered company?
Okay.
Baseco is also here.
Well, you've done your homework. Okay,
Baseco.
Okay, Baseco.
Various cases. So, again, he cannot say that Divina Law does not engage any of, or these companies have not engaged in Divina Law. If you don't believe that Smartmatic is under their payroll, I have the first page at least of their engagement letter.
Of Divina Law?
Of Divina Law.
Sent to your husband.
Sent to Andy from Ellie Moreno, and then you can see.
Okay, and
it says preparation, drafting of proposed amendments to the Omnibus Election Code of the Philippines. Now, I'm not a lawyer. But what would Smartmatic, why would they pay Divina Law, right, to help prepare, what is this, drafting of proposed amendments to our Omnibus Election Code?
Okay. All right. Now, you are going, some might think, way out of your league here by going this detailed. We're moving into the integrity of the elections. And Andy as Comelec chairman. This is a whole other issue right now. Are you saying, Tisha, you believe, based on reading these documents, that Andy compromised his position as Comelec chairman?
Let me tell you what I think, okay, with regard to that. We complain about so many things about our country, the traffic, the economy, the politics, and yet much of what we find is what we've chosen, what we've allowed. And I understand what you're saying. This is much bigger than I am, much bigger than a domestic squabble, and I know that. I can't say for sure that this belongs there. But all I know is that at this point in time, with what I have seen, I cannot allow. You have to make a conscious choice. Because I can't stop, you know, we have to choose differently. We have to stop complaining about what we get if that's what we choose. Not just what we actively choose, but what we allow. And at least for this moment, I cannot allow this. Now, I don't know where it's going to go. You know, I have bodyguard. Life is different, okay, for me. But at this point, I have to walk, like I told you, I have to walk the talk. Yes, this is scary beyond what I probably know, okay? I don't know where this will lead, but all I can tell you is this is what I found. And I think it's important enough because it will tell, you know, yesterday I was inundated by all of the support from people that I don't know, people I haven't seen in 25 years, and they know who they are, and they offer their help as lawyers, as doctors, as priests, as nuns, as teachers, bringing to the table whatever skill they had. And even though I don't have my family against, I mean, with me, I have all of these people, and for some, at least for some moments, I know I'm not alone. But please, you know, I appeal to them also. These are going to be public documents, right? Do not allow. We have to stop complaining about our life.
It's almost like you really talk like you have no attachment to Andy whatsoever. You speak of him like you weren't...
not married.
Yes.
Andy is a father of my children, right? I said, in that respect, like I said, that will never change. But I also think that, you know, my kids, I was talking to my kids, and I guess to draw from a very, very modern analogy, I think it's Spider-Man. My kids, I have four boys.
Yeah.
So I talk in that language, right? Where with great power comes great responsibility. He should have known better. If this is true, if it points in that direction, he is an extremely gifted person. He is extremely, what is the word, professionally equipped for this.
Yeah.
You have great power, you have great responsibility. Do not waste it.
Yeah.
And for me, like I said, it's not, you know, again, for my kids, it's not your father, your mother, you know, fighting with your father, or he said, she. It's beyond that. Because again, at the end of the day, you have to say it's not okay. Corruption is not okay if this is corruption, right? But we will never know unless somebody goes forward and shows this. And then if it's not, then great, it's
Mm-mm.
not.
Mm-mm.
But what if it Mm-mm. is?
Okay, Andy said, and I want to ask this, he said that what you did was stealing from him by ransacking his private stuff when he was away.
Ma'am.
Okay, this is a good question from Joanna.
Ma'am, any first-year law student would know, ma'am, that since they own everything in common and these things were found in their conjugal dwelling, ma'am, no criminal liability attaches to Mrs. Bautista for what she did.
So in you're saying
yes,
if
ma'am.
I go over my husband's things?
Yes, ma'am.
You mean I can open his mail?
Well,
no,
ma'am,
I mean, I'm just curious, under
ma'am,
the law.
There will be no criminal liability. Uh-huh. That's my opinion on your end. Because technically, ma'am, everything he has and everything you has belong to the community property. And therefore, ma'am, you should be as transparent to each other as possible. And I think, ma'am, there's definitely no criminal liability. Even for the withdrawal, ma'am, no criminal liability will attach to Mrs.
Account.
Bautista.
Yeah.
Several legal experts have said that. And we've consulted a lot of senior lawyers. And they said no criminal liability will attach.
Okay.
For the things she's done.
Because Andy said when he came back from the States, you told him not to come back home, and he felt he's the victim here, and he felt he was like a rape victim.
I don't think in this situation Andy is at all powerless. You can see from, this is a media war already, and something that I would be the last person to participate in. Okay, but you can see it is. So please, let us not pretend that he is a victim. Let us not pretend that he is powerless, because he is not. He has a lot of money and funding behind him. He has his connections, as I've been told. He has his friends. I'm by myself, right? I have no, what is my motivation to do this other than to protect my children, to do what I feel at least is right? And that's it. And you know, again, if it's the money, Martin, like he said, I will have to get it through the courts. I am being helped by friends who just want to help because, again, they understand the situation. I have four sons. So, I mean, it is what it is, though. But we were still with this.
Yeah. We have 3 minutes to go, but please.
Yes, we for Smartmatic and all, I found also checks that from Nilo Divina's account, and you'll see it from BDO. And there were amounts of $500,000 each. Two to Susan Afan and
the sister,
and one to his mother. And again, these are
and someone might ask, what's wrong with that? I mean, what if, you know, engaged their services on something private?
My mother-in-law is 85 years old, and I don't know, Susan works in a foundation.
Here,
right?
Yeah.
So I don't know, but there, again, Susan's name is there, right? She has accounts there as well, right?
So actually, ma'am, we were doing an analysis of what we found, and we were trying to compare, ma'am, the information that we found in those bank books and matching it with the financial capacity of the depositors, ma'am. So the owners were very senior citizens, or Ma'am Susan. So it appears that it's greatly disproportionate to their projected income, based on when we analyzed some of them.
Okay, all right. I'll let you close with a statement, Tisha. We have a minute left. At least, I mean, you've come out. This is very big for you to do this, and it surprised a lot of people. Where would you? What end do you see? I think. For you and your kids, what end do you see to this?
Again, this is a very, I guess, precarious situation. And really, I do this for my kids, and they may or may not understand this now, and it's difficult for them. But, you know, they're in a school that teaches them to be a man for others. I went to the same school. Andy went to the same school. And, you know, you realize that it's not just about helping other people. It's about standing up for yourself and what you believe. And I hope that at the end of this, after all of this is resolved somehow, they will understand also why I did it and how important it was that they are taught that certain things are not allowed and certain things you have to stand up for. And I, you know, although it doesn't feel that way now, I really hope that one day, you know, their mom makes them proud somehow.
On that note, Patricia Bautista, thank you for coming to Head Start. Yeah. Attorney Martin Loan, thank you very much. That's Head Start today. Replay of this interview is at 10:30 a.m. today. You can catch it on the full interview on iwanttv.com.ph. It's also uploaded on ANC Alerts, the page of ANC, and also ABS-CBN Online. And tomorrow, we will have Comelec Chairman Andy Bautista to share his side to these allegations. I'm Karen Davila. Thank you for watching. Market Edge with Kathy Ann is up next.